Here we go.
I think we're on now. Right.
Are we on?
Welcome to the first. Yeah, I think we're on the first SWN podcast, video one as well, with the Asian sensation, Umar Mohammed. I am saying that right. I feel like I always say it wrong when I'm saying it out loud.
It's Omar, but you know.
Omar. I think I actually used to spell it as Omar until you corrected me very quickly. I'll remember that now. So it's Omar Mohammed. Now it's going to be returned.
Back in high school, there was this music teacher that I absolutely loved. And then he would always like, because my name's like such a weird spelling, he was like, oh, come on, Umar. Or like, Umar. And I was like, it's Umar. And he was like, okay, I'm sorry. I'll say it right. Like, 20 minutes later, he's like, all right, Umar, come here. And I'm like, right. Like, we're not again anyway.
I was quite lucky then with a name like Billy. I just had every child in school rhyme it with things. But, you know, everyone can see it.
Oh, no.
So, I've said your name. I'll say your name right now. Welcome to the first ever SWN podcast, the pilot episode, Omar Mohammed. Tell us a little bit about yourself. Age, a little MSN, ASL. You may be too young for that, actually. But age.
MSN, yeah.
Yeah, so a little bit about yourself.
So, name's Omar Mohammed, the Asian sensation. 19, just turned 19 like a couple of weeks ago. Yeah, well, just under a month ago, so yeah. From Kirkcaldy, Scotland. Training for just coming up for about 3 years, and then shows for about 2 years. So
you're now at Fife Pro Wrestling Asylum, is that right?
Around Scotland, but still making a mark.
Yeah. So sorry, audio's cutting in and out, but we're fine. So Fife Pro Wrestling Asylum, that's where you're at now.
We're fine.
Yeah. You started.
Yeah.
Right, there's a delay. We're working on it. you started at W3L, is that right? The Action Academy.
So started there in July in 2017, and then was there till FPWA started, which was October last year. So then that's when I moved on.
Was it just a case of it's closer, or you wanted to be under tutelage of Andy Wilde and Johnny Lyons?
I mean, it was like a lot of factors that kind of played into it. Course one being Johnny Lyons, of course. I mean, like, he was training me at W3L, and then when I found out that he was going to FPWA and then Andy was there, I thought this would probably be a good time to move on and sort of expand my horizons. Even like training at W3L, kind of felt like I was there for about 2 years, so I felt that I kind of learned what I need to there, but I felt like I wanted to learn more, and I felt like I can get that FPWA.
Of course, and especially when it's got such links to GPWA and opportunities from that as well. So I'm going to...
Oh, absolutely,
I think I'd be remiss to not do this podcast with you and not speak about one of your first matches that I actually saw, which is, of course, the Action Academy. What was it? The Academy Unleashed show that I watched. And thankfully you didn't see a year later or something like that, where I just tore apart your footwear. I'm so glad the last few times I've seen you at Fair City on their shows on Vimeo that I don't see those shoes, and that you're just like totally different in comparison. You can definitely see how you've grown since that first show. What was your thoughts when you went into that Action Academy show?
Like the review that you gave me was fine because it was totally justified. had I actually came out to what I was going to be wearing, it would have been a whole different story. It would have been much more savage than what you'd written. Like, going into the Action Academy was a good experience. I'd say put it that way. Just like, it's my first show, and then got your family and friends there. I think it was a weird match, to be fair, because it was a 3-on-2. I haven't really had a lot of tag matches in general, so kind of been put into a 3-on-2 tag with John Kerr, who's at FPW now, and a trainee called Matt Black. He was there for a while. He was there like just under the amount of time that I was there, but then left like shortly after. So he didn't have a lot of training experience. So it was kind of like a mixed tag match, if you get what I mean.
Yeah, and it was against Kevin Williams and was it Dave Jeremy? Was it? I can't remember.
Yeah, it was. Kevin Boston, Dave Jeremy.
Okay. So you're in with the two guys who've been around for a while. I mean, Kevin, of course, he's been around since, seems like forever, at least over 10 years. So it's good to get in with guys that have got a bit of experience. Oh, my internet connection apparently is unstable. So.
Oh, like, definitely.
Carry on. but yeah, so it's
like,
it's,
even. Yeah.
Yeah. So from that point, you've now done several shows, Fair City Wrestling, and you've done GPWA. You actually won our match for the month, I think, if I remember rightly, for your £5 wrestling show against Talon Jr.
Honestly, I was surprised about that. I was very much surprised about that.
I'll be honest.
I mean, you had,
so was I. But,
you had a lot of matches in there.
yeah, I mean, like, not that I'm surprised there was a good match. I'm surprised that
good matches in there.
Yeah, exactly.
Man, what the heck?
I know, but it just goes to show how you've came from that first show and where you are now, that folk are getting behind you and are supporting you. So let's speak about Fair City Wrestling, because that's where I would say that's your main promotion. That's where you've appeared the most in matches, I would say. Would that be fair? So you're teaming with Alpha Male a couple times.
Yep.
What's it like wrestling for Fair City Wrestling down in Perth?
I would say it's pretty good. I've kind of taken a break everything at the moment, hoping to be back there probably when the shows come back next year. I don't know if I'll still be tagging with Alpha Male. It just depends on what's happening next year, if the feuds that are happening now, if you get what I mean, are moving on.
It's a bit of a weird time at the moment.
Honestly, it was a great experience.
So how are you finding your lockdown time? You find ways just to keep, I mean, I know that you've been doing like promos and all that kind of stuff to during our clan warfare tournaments and all that kind of thing, to keep you a bit sharp, but is there anything that you've been doing to try and keep your wrestling skills going?
I mean, still trying to like maintain a workout every time that I can. Even like, it was quite difficult because I just had the month of Ramadan that just happened. So that and accompanied with being stuck in lockdown was, I'm not going to say awful, but yeah, it was pretty terrible.
So, I mean, I'm just very unfamiliar with that kind of stuff. So is Ramadan's like, is that your fasting? Is that right? Or I'm totally clueless.
So like Ramadan is sort of a month in the Islamic calendar in which from one full moon to when like the cycle of a full moon. So from one, when one full moon like starts and then it goes to another full moon, between that month, that's when you're fasting every single day from sunrise to sunset.
Right. Okay. So yeah, if you're trying to fit in a workout as well, that's just, yeah, that sounds, that does not sound great at all.
Even Andy was like trying to throw in these like weekly workouts, and I'm like, all right, let's try and get this done.
Yeah, I'm sitting here just with like food next to me because I'm just doing a podcast, let alone thinking of doing a workout at the same time. You have my sympathies for that. So Andy at FBWATT is kind of just trying to keep everyone kind of going with these with online classes, is that right? And just trying to keep everyone kind of going during this time.
Yeah, even like in our private, we've got like a private FPWA page, which Andy keeps on like motivating us. He like sends a message every week saying, how's everyone getting on? We're still getting our workouts in. Is everyone eating right and all that stuff? Just like making sure everyone's doing okay. And then you've got the online coaching as well, which everyone in the UK should get on because it's a fantastic page. Andy puts in like matches, puts in seminars. Honestly, he's doing so much for the wrestling community. It's unreal.
Yeah, I've been seeing some like screenshots from just after it's finished. There's just so many folk in the chat, and it's really good to see that people are just not resting. And oh, it's a pandemic. There's no shows on. What's the point of me actually doing any of this stuff? Mm-hmm. But at least they're getting the opportunities to still do it. So that's fantastic. Right, let's go right back a bit because we've done interviews with you before on the website. Which people have read, mm-hmm. But for those that haven't, which they should, but for those that haven't, what got you into wrestling?
I think it was kind of like it was pretty much a family thing. Like my granddad used to be a boxer, so he would be in Manchester. He came from Pakistan when he was from a young age. Was in Manchester, and he would be training how to be a boxer. And his cousin was training with Jackie Paolo from World of Sport. So I think there was kind of like a wrestling element there. And then as like my dad was born and my uncles were born, that's when they started to watch wrestling because that was the time when, you know, you had your Hulk Hogan going into Bret Hart, Shawn Michaels, into like the Attitude Era. And then when it was like 2001 was when I was born. So then that's when like it started a bit. But my family, we still watch wrestling. And then it was like 2008 when I started getting into wrestling because I think they were watching like the Royal Rumble. Or I think it was like around Royal Rumble, WrestleMania 2014, and we're like, we started watching stuff, and I was like, oh, Jeff Hardy, he's pretty cool. He's like diving all over the place. So then I kind of started like YouTube and all that stuff, and then getting into it like that.
You're absolutely speaking to the right person when it comes to who you're Jeff Hardy, just yeah, one of my absolute favorites. And 2008, perfect time to get into Jeff Hardy because that was when he was 2008 Royal Rumble. That would have been him versus Randy Orton for the WWE title. That'd be right. John Cena came back in the Rumble.
Yeah,
yeah, and that was the end of the year. He won the title. Yeah, Jeff Hardy knowledge. That's my remit. So yeah, when I started, it was the Hardy Boys, 1998, 1999.
Yeah,
so. Which does not make me feel old at all that you're speaking about getting into Jeff Hardy in 2008. but yeah, I'm loving it. I've actually Hardy Boys tattoo. That's how committed I was to the cause. But yeah, so 2008, it was pretty much, I say, peak of the, like, I wouldn't call it like the reality era or just this PG era that came in. So, when you go back, is there anything that piques your interest? I mean, I know you mentioned Bret Hart, Attitude Era, kind of bit, Hulk Hogan. Is there anyone that you went back to and noticed and became a fan of?
I mean, even guys like Shawn Michaels and stuff, his matches with The Undertaker in Hell in a Cell, his matches with Stone Cold and Bret Hart and stuff, like kind of like the showman. Of course, like Mr. WrestleMania, his entrances and his performances were just unreal. So it kind of gravitated towards him. Even like The Rock as well. The Rock's like, he's one of the biggest wrestlers of all time. And the way he talked, the way he like presented himself in the ring and outside the ring is like one of the things that I try to aspire to be.
Attitude era
around that time.
Yeah, I think you can definitely see that when I've been watching your matches, that you're very much in tune with the showman side of it, like being very charismatic, getting the crowd involved, which for someone who's only been wrestling for, what, 2 years on live shows, I would say is quite a skill to have at this stage. Because you can see guys that have been wrestling for 3-4 years and still don't know how to get a crowd involved in a match. They seem to, you find a way to get them to gravitate to you, which is fantastic. Which can only get better once all the shows come back into action again.
I think it was just like a switch between, like, because I was kind of, this like when I debuted, debuted in WPL. I was kind of like just sort of this basic heelish character, and then it was, I think it was the match with Kevin Williams in at Remedy. I think that's somewhere on the WPL network. That's when I first wore like that long fancy jacket.
I think I've actually watched that
long
match.
Fancy blue jacket in the shades.
Yeah. I think that's probably where my turning point for you was as well, when I saw it, and I was just like, who is that guy in that match I saw before?
Exactly.
This guy now. This unbelievable. But yeah, so it's so you, I will always say that your journey has been one that I've seen grow. Which makes me feel like I've watched wrestling forever. But like I said, it's only been 2 years on live shows, and you just went leaps and bounds. Right, so we've done the basics, why you got into wrestling, who your favourites are. Again, back to the questions we've already asked you, and you've rolled back great responses, but it's been a while since you've done them, and you've had shows since. Is there any opponents that you've particularly liked to face? Is there anyone that you've had matches with and just had instant chemistry with already in this early stage of your career?
I mean, someone asked this on that Q&A that I did, I think, a couple of days ago. There isn't, like, I've been very fortunate to have a lot, like, most of my matches have been with, like, really, really, like, dependable opponents and wrestlers. So, like, Caleb Valhalla, Talon Jr., Taylor Bryden, Johnny Lyons as well. Ken Cade and Zach Leo, like these guys have all been like main faces in their promotions, and then me just coming along and having a match with them, I'm just like, I kind of feel that I'm starting to get into the swing of it, not because of like my skills, but because they're elevating me to their level.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you're just kind of trying to keep up, but you're keeping up with them and just keep going. Fantastic. So, goals for the future. Obviously, nothing's happening right now, as we've firmly established on this video or on this podcast. Is there any promotions that you want to be aiming to get onto? I mean, you've done Fair Say, which again we've mentioned plenty of times. You've done GPWA, WrestleZone, done WrestleZone as well, and of course W3L. So, is there anywhere that's your focus you want to get to? When the shows return?
I mean, like, for me personally, the goals that I want to achieve, that was I was hoping to get to before lockdown was, before lockdown happened, would be a debut at ICW and Discovery Wrestling. Those are like my top two promotions that I want to work for in the future.
So have you had a chance to, I know the FPWA guys are regular crew there now at Discovery Wrestling. Have you been part of the crew? Has you got a feel for the backstage and the setup there?
I was there at the All About the Raffle. I was there for that show, which was, honestly, it was a great experience to see, like, geez, that was put on there, and then to just meet the guys backstage and just get a feel for what Discovery really is.
Did you have a ticket ready for to go? Because all these wrestlers having their raffle tickets ready. Were you just waiting there, waiting for your number to be called?
Yeah, I have my ticket.
Okay, so Discovery Wrestling, and just go for, again, easy questions. This is a pilot, I don't want to get anything too complicated going. Dream opponents. So I'm assuming one's going to be Jeff Hardy. I'll assume that one.
Jeff Hardy, yeah.
anyone else? Is there anyone, AEW, WWE, Impact, whoever, would be your opponent you'd want to face when the shows are back? And you told you could face anyone in the world right now, who'd it be?
I mean, there's two opponents in terms of Scottish wrestling that I really want to work. One of them is, of course, Johnny Lyons. The guy has trained me since I started, and we never technically had a match on the show. So even just a match with him would be amazing, but of course he's retired, so we can't do that. Please unretire Johnny.
Only matter of time. No wrestler stays retired. Like, that's what we've all learned from these.
Honestly, I'm going to force him. I'm going to force him to unretire just for one match.
Well, hopefully it's up my end of the woods. Hopefully it's WrestleZone and I can see it. But if not, I'm sure I'll find a way to watch it. Who would be the other one then?
The other guy is Taylor Bryden.
Okay.
He was like, of course we know each other from W3L. The guy is making an unbelievable comeback. He was kind of like in the tag team division at the start of Scottish wrestling in the 2000s. He's kind of taking a dip at the moment, but he is one of my biggest supporters. And we've been talking about it for ages. We're like, every single time we're at the same promotion, when something happens and we don't get to wrestle each other. So, like, hopefully one day we get to wrestle each other, and it would be a very enjoyable match.
Excellent. And worldwide, who'd it be?
Worldwide? I'm trying to think. Even, like, It's a tough one. I think like, there's so much talent out there. Even like Cody Rhodes, getting an opportunity to work with him on a stage like AEW. Daniel Bryan, another guy that I'd really like to work. Just go out there and have a great technical match, because like seeing his match with AJ Styles from last SmackDown, I was like, that is what I want to do.
I've actually seen it. I've been keeping up with the pay-per-views because we're in lockdown. I work in my living room, so I can just watch pay-per-views, go upstairs, sleep for 3 hours, then come back down. I look like total. Oh, I almost broke the swearing thing. I can look rubbish. it's fine.
The pay-per-views have been really good this past couple of months.
But for Daniel Bryan's match with Drew Gulak is probably one of my favourite matches this year. Every show I've watched for WWE at the moment, I've always found there's one match I went, that's one of the best matches of the year.
That's a good one, yeah.
Yeah, so even with no crowd, it's just been great. I've had a good time, which, to be honest, for me, that's the most important thing. So as long as I'm having a good time watching, like, then great.
It's insane to think about, like, because of course you think, oh, the wrestling's going to be over, and then WWE keeps on putting out, like, these different concepts, like, The Money in the Bank match.
Yeah.
Where they were fighting really across, like, the corporate buildings, WWE headquarters.
Yeah. There were some bits of it.
Remember
I was
when
just
they
like,
announced that. Oof.
Yeah, I was like, some bits of it during match, I was like, no. But the general concept of it, I really enjoyed. Things like Baron Corbin breaking a mirror right at the start. And since then, Gary Cassidy pointed out on Twitter, since then, he's not won a match or he's had bad luck happen to him, and it's not been mentioned. But I just love that. I love that there's actually a subtlety, which WWE are not known for, but there's been subtlety since Baron Corbin broke a mirror in Money in the Bank. He has had the worst luck ever. But yeah, the Money in the Bank one's been strange. Was strange, but like things like Firefly Funhouse match and all that. So for you, if shows could come back, but there'd be no crowd, how do you think that would? Because you're a showman, you like hit the crowd on your side. How would you feel wrestling in front of nobody?
I mean, like, the crowd pretty much makes the match. To see the guys on, like, Raw and SmackDown stuff still wrestling without a crowd is insane. Like, even at, like, a W3L training, they're, like, because there'd be, like, there's a few of us there, but there would be two of us in the ring having the match. One of us is a ref. And then maybe like two or three as the crowd. Even that is still like, you still got something there. But then to have no one, I don't know. I feel like that would probably be like the biggest task that I'd had to face in wrestling. Wrestling without a crowd.
At this rate, you might have to take up the challenge. But fingers crossed. I mean, well, like you're saying, they have like other trainees and that there as well. So hopefully, if things do come back, that will be the setup for a little bit. You'll have people that are on the show, trainees and all that kind of hanging about. Mm-hmm.
It'd be fun to try, I guess. But I don't know if it was something I'd be really like, let's have a match about a crowd.
Yeah, you wouldn't be the first to volunteer for it that way. Right, so I think we've covered pretty much all the cool stuff, all the easy stuff, favourites, and I didn't ask about your favourite match, so we just start with you watched 28 Wrestling 2008, and obviously the matches with Shawn Michaels and Undertaker, but what would be your top three favourite matches of all time, anywhere, Scottish wrestling, WWE, AEW, Japan, wherever?
Well, probably like one of the top would be Sami Zayn versus Shinsuke Nakamura at, was it NXT TakeOver Dallas, I think?
Quite possibly. I know it was at a TakeOver, but that was about it.
Uh-huh. I remember watching that match and I was like, That's the reason why I want to be a wrestler. Like, seeing the motion and just, like, the strikes, how efficient and clean everything was. And I just felt myself getting more and more invested. I was just like, that's a good match.
Okay, so that's number one. What would be your second?
Number one. I would say... what's it? It was from the Cruiserweight Classic. There's, I think, like, even the Cruiserweight Classic itself, that's probably one of my favourite matches, because there's so many matches I could pick from the Cruiserweight Classic. I'd have to go with probably the finals, T.G. Perkins versus Grand Metalik.
Right, I didn't watch any of it, so I'm taking your word for it. But I think I saw you tweeting, was it end of last year? That you revisited it all and watched it again, and we're just tweeting.
Billy,
about
you
it.
need to get on the Cruiserweight Classic.
I've got so much time now, and I work next to my TV, so I've been putting WWE pay per views on. I've been working through 2002. That's been my week. I've been just playing them one after the other while I'm at work. I'm kind of like half paying attention, but half not. Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna have to get the Cruiserweight Classic, get some more recent stuff because I would have to wake up and go to work. I was only catching the Royal Rumble, WrestleMania. Mm-hmm. That would be it. That would be my yearly stay up and take Monday off. But now I can watch everything. So I'm going to have to do some catching up for years of neglect. Only watching things on YouTube clips at 2 minutes in the morning the next day. So you're going to recommend to me the Cruiserweight Classic. I'll bear that in mind.
Cruiserweight Classic. Got to watch it.
Number three.
Number three, I would have to say Shawn Michaels Undertaker WrestleMania 25.
Oh, yeah, That's, yeah.
It's such a good match.
Definitely can't argue with that at all.
Like that whole sort of series that they had, Taker Michaels 25, Taker Michaels 26, then Triple H Undertaker 27, and then the end of an era match. I always find that like the perfect story in four matches.
Have you watched the kind of recap of that in the Undertaker's documentary that's on the network just now? Kind of speaking about
I'm hooked on it.
I absolutely love it. I mean, to be honest, I really just use the network. That before I'm at home working, I just used it for the documentaries, and that Undertaker one is just insane. Mm-hmm. So can't wait.
Do you remember the documentary series that they did? It was Breaking Ground.
Again, remember of it, haven't watched it. So I'll put it on my list.
It's like a 10-part series of the backstage of NXT. So you'd have like guys who are on the main roster now, like Tyler Breeze, Bayley, Sasha Banks, all these guys, Jason Jordan when he was in the tag with Chad Gable, sort of their rise. And then I wish they did that now with like a lot of the newer guys.
Yeah, was that the one, again, hearing about it, was that the one we saw Leo Kruger become Adam Rose, kind of playing about with that character?
Yeah.
Okay.
So it was like the very, very beginning of NXT.
Yeah, okay. Cool. I'll add that to my list of things to catch up on from years of watching, of years of missing things. Okay, so one thing we've been chatting for about a good half an hour. I think that's a good kind of stopping off point. So before we cap off the recording, and I don't think I've had to edit anything, we haven't sworn, which is great.
Plug your social media. Itself.
Exactly. Plug your social media. Where can people find you?
So you could find me on Twitter at @sensation_CTP, on Instagram at Professor of Islamonomics, and Facebook at The Asian Sensation.
Professor of Islamonomics is like, I can't say it's a tongue twister in itself, but I love that moniker, so hope you keep that forever.
Asian Sensation was taken, so I was like, Doctor of Thugonomics, Professor of Islamonomics, we're going for it.
I love it. But yeah, thank you for joining me for this first edition. Hopefully we'll get to do more, but we'll I'll go out just as soon as I can get it out, not in a creepy way, but we'll get it out as soon as we can, and I will tag you all over the place, and hopefully we'll do more of them.
And I will retweet and quote and do everything.
Excellent. We'll be back again with you, I'm sure, in a year's time when you've won many titles and are everywhere.
That's the ultimate goal right there.
Yeah. Well, first you've got to win the title in our SWN universe, then we can all go up from there. But thank you for that,
my CV.
Exactly. I think you should. But right, I'm going to stop recording shortly, but thank you very much, and we'll have a wee chat afterwards as well once I've hit stop. But perfect. Right. Thank you very much.
Perfect. Thank you.